Harper Audio presents The Confidence Course, 7 Steps to Self-Fulfillment, written and read by Walter Anderson. Nothing can arouse anticipation more quickly in nearly everyone I know than a simple request. Will you stand up before our group? My most vivid memory of this kind of fear goes all the way back to my 7th grade class at Emmanuel Lutheran School in Mount Vernon, New York. This is a story I originally told in 1986 in my first book, Courage is a 3-letter Word. I had turned 13 only a few months before, and I believed all eyes were on me, burning right through the back of my neck as surely as if they were spotlights. As I look back over my life, despite thousands of other mistakes and embarrassments, this was my most humiliating moment. Our teacher had ordered me to remove my shirt and stand at my desk. What bothered him was that I had my shirt collar up, a style worn by adolescents in the 1950s. He was going to make me an example before my classmates. "Take off your shirt," he ordered. I promised not to wear my collar up again. "I've caught you twice," he said, striding to my desk. "Take it off." He had me, and he knew it. Mount Vernon, 4 square miles of 75,000 people, living just beyond the Bronx, the northernmost borough of New York City, is a town with a tear in its belly, a railroad cut right down its middle. I lived deep in the south side of town in a tenement on a street where kids often wore motorcycle jackets, greased their hair, talked hard, and tried to look unafraid. A neighborhood where the corner, however violent, was safer than the explosive tension at home, my home. Emmanuel was deep in the north side, the right side of the tracks, in a section called Fleetwood. It might just as easily have been halfway across the world. It had prosperity, and it had peace. I crossed the tracks to go home every night, home to a block where kids wore their collars up. He was a tall man, and his body blocked any chance I might have had to run. Somebody giggled. "Please," I pleaded. "Now!" I unbuttoned the front of my shirt. "Hurry up!" I opened my cuffs and slipped the shirt off, draping it behind me on the chair. My undershirt had holes in it. Several people giggled. "Stand up!" I stood up. The teacher, who had been standing beside my desk, marched back to the front of the classroom. He had been bullying me all year. Having forgotten to turn my collar down, I had given the teacher what he had been looking for. I stood alone. I heard my heart beat louder in my ears. The heat at the base of my neck was becoming unbearable. For a 13-year-old boy, his worst secret had been revealed. The undershirt with its holes for all to see proved I was poor, proved I was a Southsider, unworthy of the Northsiders in the classroom. Maybe it was seconds, maybe it was minutes before I reached for my shirt. It seemed like a lifetime. "I didn't tell you to move," the teacher said from the front of the class. I ignored him as I buttoned my shirt and sat down. The bell rang for recess before he got to me. "Wait," he ordered. Everybody stopped. "Just Walter," he amended. One or two students hesitated by the door, hoping to hear what he was going to say. "Move," he told them. "You are going to learn to listen to me," he said, and I was silent. "Go to recess." I walked to the door, turned back to the teacher, and called out his name. "Yes?" "Why don't you go to hell?" I said, my eyes filling with tears. From the depths of my anxiety, I had found the right response. It was not my words, which, because of the provocation, were deliberately disrespectful. It was that I had asserted myself. In that moment, I had discovered the roots of my own dignity. I had dared to be myself. My mother, though she certainly did not condone my behavior, understood it, and stood by me when I was threatened with expulsion. The following night, she pleaded with the school board to allow me to remain as a student until June. Then she promised the members, who patiently heard her plea, she would transfer me elsewhere. Anywhere, she was advised. Vindicated, the teacher, for the most part, stopped the bullying. I quietly finished the school year. I met Dr. Norman Vincent Peale when Courage is a 3-letter Word was published. 3 years later, well after we had become friends, he asked me to write an article on forgiveness for his magazine, Guidepost. The piece, which appeared in November 1989, was titled My Toughest Struggle. I described how, as an adult, I had learned to understand my father's alcoholism and thus was able, finally, to control the anger that had raged within me for years. I received many letters as a result of that article, but there was one that touched me more than all the others. Dear Walter, it began, I'm really sorry I made you take off your shirt and embarrassed you in front of the class. I had forgotten all about it until I read it in your book this morning, and oh, how ashamed I am that I did something like that, especially since I was there to teach you and the other young people love. It turned out, he wrote, that his wife had read the article in Guideposts and suspected I was the same Walter Anderson who had been in his class at Emmanuel 3 decades earlier. When he visited the local library the next morning, he found a copy of Courage is a Three-Letter Word, and he discovered the passage that described what had occurred between us. He explained in his letter how, when he was a boy, he was picked on repeatedly and mercilessly by street toughs, and this bullying had left a painful impression on him. Walter, I was at least as afraid of you as you were of me. I thought you were the dead-end kids and blackboard jungle all rolled into one. Who knows how much your inner self saw me as your threatening father, and how much my inner self saw you as the bullies who terrified me as a child. I'm so sorry things weren't different, and I know that as the adult, it was up to me to set the example. To help me understand his state of mind at the time, he wrote about terrible hardships he, his wife, and his family had endured, and he expressed a wish. I hope and pray that you forgive me. I had forgiven him, of course, years ago. First, however, I had to grow from an angry adolescent into a confident adult. The journey was sometimes painful. But isn't life all about ups and downs, and about learning from both? So is the confidence course. I hope that you will have grown as well as you take your journey now through the confidence course. The confidence course comes from my own life experiences and from those of the hundreds of eminently successful people I've come to know well over the last 3 decades. I've learned to speak and write clearly, effectively, and most important, with confidence, no matter how chicken I feel. I believe human beings can transform themselves, and I know that real confidence comes only from experience. Thus, you'll learn in the confidence course what I have learned in language that's direct, how to worry well. That's right, worry well, which is to discover how to harness your anxiety and diminish your aching feelings of inferiority. Let's start. The first and most important of the 7 steps to self-fulfillment is 1. Know who is responsible. Accept personal responsibility for your behavior. When you say, I am responsible, you can build a new life, even a new world. Theologians and philosophers have observed and preached for centuries the simple truth that destiny is not something that happens to you, not something you wait for. Destiny is a choice, your choice. You choose the life you lead. Each of us has the capacity to make happiness happen. I can hold your hand, share a good cry, commiserate, tell you that I know life is not fair, that you got dealt a crummy hand, that you've been cheated by things outside your control. I can say with conviction that I understand and sympathize with the fact that we cannot prevent all of the disappointments, losses, and tragedies that occur in our lives. And I realize that we are not born with equal abilities. So where does that leave us? Right where we began, with the first of the 7 steps to self-fulfillment. Know who is responsible. I am responsible. Although I may not be able to prevent the worst from happening, I am responsible for my attitude toward the inevitable misfortunes that darken life. Bad things do happen. How I respond to them defines my character and the quality of my life. I can choose to sit in perpetual sadness, immobilized by the gravity of my loss, or I can choose to rise from the pain and to treasure the most precious gift I have, life itself. When, finally and with no excuses, you accept responsibility for your own life, you not only gain incredible power to achieve positive goals and be more confident, but you are also able to diminish the pain that inevitably accompanies an emotional wound. To fully accept responsibility, though, we need to understand who we really are. Have you ever asked yourself, "Who am I?" Three factors determine who you are: heredity, environment, and most important, your responses to both. You are the only you who will ever live. In front of a mirror or in front of a microphone, you are who you are. And accepting this plain truth can be both the toughest and the most rewarding challenge of your life. There has never been anyone quite like you or me. Who you are evolves from the potential you have inherited, the opportunities you receive, and the choices you make. The final factor, your response to heredity and environment, is profoundly important. It is your choices that make you uniquely you. We are handed our heredity with no apologies, and our environment is often beyond our control. We have the power, though, to face life, to make choices, and most important, to hope. True hope dwells on the possible, even when life seems to be a plot written by someone who wants to see how much adversity we can overcome. True hope responds to the real world, real life. It is an active effort. False hope, on the other hand, is dangerous. It is pathological. False hope is the cancer patient denying his illness. True hope recognizes the disease and seeks to conquer it or cope with it. The spirit of the confidence course is true hope, the certain knowledge that you and I are not helpless. Gaining confidence, like living with true hope, is a conscious, active effort. So, during the next 7 days, pay attention to all examples you observe of true hope versus false hope, the little incidents as well as the big ones. You may be surprised to discover how many instances you note. Keep a list. Examine the examples you have gathered at the end of the week. Include in your analysis these questions. Do others respond in the same way to the person who lives with true hope and to the person who lives with false hope? In each case of true hope or false hope, what does the person involved seem to be focusing on? You'll probably discover what I and so many of the students of the Confidence Course have found. True hope is a far healthier attitude than false hope for the individuals themselves. And others are more at ease with and respond far more favorably to people who live with true hope. People who live with true hope tend to focus on solutions, while others do not. This is significant. Anxiety and fear produce energy. Where we focus that energy noticeably affects the quality of our lives. Focus on the solution, not the problem. When faced with a disturbing challenge, however large or small, ask yourself, am I dwelling on the problem or am I focusing on the solution? Do not waste worry. If you're going to worry, worry well. Put that energy to good use. Aim it at an answer. Don't forget, nothing diminishes anxiety faster than action. The late Benjamin Lee Whorf, a pioneer in the study of linguistics, once observed that our human ability to learn language allows each of us, first, to communicate with someone else, second, to think, which is to communicate with ourselves, and third, to acquire the attitudes that shape our whole outlook on life. To gain greater confidence, it helps to understand this incredible ability of ours to learn words, because confidence is an attitude. And as Whorf observed, we acquire our attitudes. By changing your words, you can change your attitude. You are what you think, and you, like me, think in language. For example, you think, I cannot speak before the class. Said as such, the not is a monster declaration. I cannot. Let's take another look at your words. I cannot speak before the class. The sentence is firm and final, isn't it? I agree that as long as you say with such conviction that you cannot speak before the class, you will not speak before the class. And no one, least of all me, is going to make you. You cannot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.